And this is Derp Talk with Sovek and Friends, episode 2. Welcome everyone. As you can see, we'll be doing some League in the background.
Yay.
As I say that, I'm quickly, hurriedly going into my volume mixer because I forgot to turn Mumble up.
And of course, if you're watching this on YouTube, you're not seeing it.
Yeah, all the video is going to be completely replaced on YouTube. So the you people watching live are going to see this, and I am not saving the Twitch version whatsoever. I'm just going to let the Twitch version fall by the wayside. If you miss it live, you're going to have to catch it on YouTube. That's just how it's going to be from now on with Derp Talk. Because Twitch just doesn't record the audio levels worth a fuck.
Don't worry, I'll give you guys on YouTube a play-by-play of the League game. Oh my god, I just penta-killed... Triple killed the whole team five times over.
Five
you should have seen
over.
It. It was amazing.
Over.
Okay, so this week we have four topics. Yeah, four topics to go over. And I just realized I forgot to turn off text to speech, so I am turning that off right now. So that doesn't happen again. FFFAN15. who would kindly please stay muted during the entirety of the podcast? All right, so Sharingan is bullshit is our first topic today, because the Sharingan is indeed goddamn fucking bullshit. Failed to join queue, what the fuck? The Sharingan's interfering with our league playing Fluxen. It's a new power.
Makes as much sense as anything else Kishi has wrote.
Yeah, it does. And
damn
I
it.
Completely lost like all mumble audio, too, for like a good 5 seconds there. That was interesting. I blame the bad weather, because it is very rainy today here in the Northeast. Failed to join queue. No, I'm just going to rearrange the team while we talk. Okay, so let's start off with when the Sharingan was a decent idea. Back in the first arc of Naruto.
Back when Kakashi had it?
Yeah, back when Kakashi had it, Sasuke sort of had it, and the only thing it really did was let you copy moves and read movements very, very well, which made you really good in a fight. But it wasn't completely and utterly bullshit like it slowly became. I mean, Itachi comes in, and Itachi introduces the idea of the Mangekyo Sharingan. It's powerful, but it had the drawback. You go blind if you keep using it. And that offset the fact that it had a bullshit genjutsu. But the bullshit genjutsu kind of fit Itachi's character, and he was the only one who had it. So we're okay with this. And then I don't think we have another bullshit Sharingan power till the time skip, if I can remember. Then the time skip happens, and we get to Kamui, which I think... Yeah, Kamui I think is the first new Sharingan power we get, and that's with Kakashi, who... has a Mangekyo Sharingan, which I believe it was partially explained by Itachi back before the time skip, that you had to be a pure-blooded Uchiha to get the Mangekyo, if I remember right.
Something like that.
I do vaguely remember Itachi saying something about that once, when he first showed up, that he had a special ability that only a true Uchiha could awaken within a Sharingan, and that's why Kakashi could never hope to defeat it. And then suddenly Kakashi has it, and his is even more bullshit, because he can just make black holes at will, apparently. But only Kakashi has it, and we establish early on that Kakashi is pretty much wiped out from using it whenever he does it, because he doesn't have like the innate resistance to the physical strain of using a Mangekyo Sharingan that a true Uchiha has. So, again, it's getting more bullshit, but it's balanced bullshit. And then Toby shows up. And Toby, at first you don't know has a Sharingan, but then you find out he has a Sharingan. And you're wondering, please tell me, does his weird ability to just phase through solid objects have anything to do with the Sharingan? Please tell me this isn't true. Please tell me it isn't true. Guess what? It's true. Sharingan gives this guy the ability to just phase through solid fucking matter. And he apparently suffers no drawbacks from it whatsoever, because he's never shown to be suffering from Sharingan blindness. He's never shown to be having any ill effects whatsoever from just spamming the hell out of his ability to just be intangible. And then you find out that he's supposedly Madara, and we just keep getting more bullshit from there. Because then we get the next thing we get is Susano, which is the next kind of bullshit one where apparently the Sharingan could just make giant skeleton men that surround you and protect you from everything while doing massive tons of damage.
Or what's his face, who has stolen a bunch of Sharingan eyes just
so Danzo, whose entire arm is just covered in Sharingan, so you can use this one jutsu that makes one eye go blind when you use it, but when you use it, you rewrite reality for a few seconds. So you can just be like, nope, I didn't die. Rewind.
Or the fire that never goes out.
No, the fire that never goes out wasn't too overpowered. Because it required line of sight, you couldn't just be like, oh, you're behind that wall. Surprise, fire's not behind that wall. And it only burned they established early on, the only thing the fire consumes is the object it first touched. It doesn't spread like normal fire. And then the Itachi fight happens, and we completely do away with that idea. But actually, no, they don't, because he lights only the trees he looked at on fire during that fight. And once those trees burn out, the fire went out. Bucks, you actually have to start this game.
Can't cue things saying weird numbers.
Oh, really? So,
Okay, the drawing queue.
League is apparently
broken. So you lied to me. And I could have been in my raid. God damn it, Sovek.
League is apparently broken today. Wonderful. Technical difficulties on the video, and I'm going to try making my own game. And then Susano was bullshit at first because we thought that Susano just automatically had the stupid ceiling sword thing. We find out it's only Itachi, but Itachi having that ceiling sword was still kind of bullshit. And then we get to the true bullshit of the Sharingan. I'm just going to skip ahead here. The idea that the Sharingan can learn things when you're dead. That, to me, was the final straw. Up till that point, every single thing the Sharingan does that's kind of an overpowered ability, I'm accepting of, because it's only ever shown one character doing it, maybe two characters at most. And then we find out that the reason Madara wasn't dead is because he actually was dead, but because Danzo took the eye from, learned Izanagi, which was the I rewrite reality jutsu, instantly fucking Madara learns how to use it. And he uses the jutsu to make himself alive. And he apparently doesn't lose an eye doing this. That's why he's been collecting eyes, so he can just keep using Izanagi and then replacing his eyes. Because it is established that he just collects eyes.
Sovek, you forget. Remember, it doesn't just learn things when it's dead. Time has no effect on the Sharingan.
Oh, right.
Because Danzo learned Izanagi in the future, Madara's eye reacted, and Madara could bring himself back to life in the past.
Oh, right. He blinds himself before he dies in the future to undie himself in the past so that he can do it again in the future.
Yeah.
It's about then where I just said, what the hell is going on?
And do you realize the problem? I'm going to just say this for the podcast. Do you realize the problem yet? Okay, the Sharingan starts off as an eye that lets you see things. Let me just liken this. Imagine in the next chapter Naruto, the Byakugan immediately let people start flying and summon dogs from hell. Because
you know,
that's about
the funny
as
thing
connected.
About you saying that, actually, is early on in the anime, it clearly states that the Sharingan is a lesser form of the Byakugan.
And the fact is, the Sharingan was an eye. How does it do all this stuff? I don't know, just because we needed to keep adding stuff to the eye, even though
But they've not added a single thing to the Byakugan!
Yep, yeah. Because Byakugan
is
interesting.
Which is supposed to be more powerful!
Hang on, the Byakugan still is more powerful. Because Kaguya is the origin of the Byakugan, and she is the first thing to ever have chakra besides the Ten Tails. So apparently that fact alone is supposed to justify the Byakugan as being more powerful. It doesn't have all the bullshit abilities, but because the super powerful godlike being at the beginning of ninja history had the Byakugan, It feels like that's Kishi's little tongue-in-cheek way of saying, see, it's still more powerful. This person had it. And all I can think of is, but they're not using it for anything. They just kind of have it. In fact, I think they've only used the Byakugan once in that entire fight. It's Kaguya's just been doing other jutsus, and apparently Kaguya can just do Dead Bone Pulse, which confirmed my earlier theory that the Kaguya clan originated from Kaguya.
Well, everything originated from Kaguya, that's the whole point.
But I feel like certain one of these three original ninjas, Kaguya, the Sage, and the Sage's brother, I feel like each current major bloodline has been passed down through one of them.
Well, no, the Sage was the son of Kaguya. So everything came from Kaguya, even the Sharingan and the Byakugan.
Everything originally came from her.
Imagine it like this. Kaguya was the original, and then every time she gave birth to the two, it was cut in half. And then when they gave children, it was cut in half. So the bloodline eventually became more and more restrictive, but originally she had everything.
Yeah. Every time her descendants reproduce, the Kekigen Kais are split in half evenly among the offspring, because they keep having two children for some reason. Everyone in her family keeps having two children until they run out of ways to split bloodlines, and they just start going having one children. It's like it was planned. Which is why I'm half expecting at some point fucking Zetsu or Kaguya just says your entire ninja world has progressed exactly as I planned it has. Which I think he kind of already has, but he hasn't outright said it yet, so I'm not counting it.
God damn it, I hate when the villain says everything is going exactly the way I wanted to. You meant to get your ass kicked League, 3 times? Yes, I did.
On a side note, League is completely busted, so I will be switching games. I just tried the solo queue and every single bot queue, and all of them told me the same thing.
So League broke. I
just want to get into like Kishimoto's head and see where... I want to see that one junction where he decides, you know what, the eye that originally made sense, that the eye could see things, yeah, let's let that eye start doing fire powers or dimension powers. Just, what is the connection between an eyeball and fire and dimension jumping powers?
Yeah.
Where did that come from? The stretch of logic for a dimension jump, the eyes can see past the dimensional barriers into other dimensions.
Actually, that is exactly that is exactly how Kamui works.
God damn it!
That is exactly how Kamui can see into its own pocket, because what we find out eventually, because you don't know this yet, Obito also has Kamui. Kamui is actually two jutsus, one in each eye. Kakashi only has one half of Kamui, because he's not a pure-blooded Uchiha. Because Obito has the Rinnegan and he's pure-blooded, his one Mangekyo Sharingan was able to give himself both versions of the eye's power in his eye, which allows him to pull people into the dimension and pull them out of the dimension. Kakashi can only suck them into the dimension. He can't go there himself. He can only put other things in there. Whereas Obito can only take himself and anything he's touching into it.
I was only joking about that. Eventually, you mean to tell me that's the actual reason?
Yeah. And Kakashi eventually learns that he can also take other things out of it, but not himself. So literally the way Kamui works is one eye is the eye that affects other things in and out of another dimension, and the other eye affects yourself in and out of the same dimension. Mm-hmm. Which doesn't explain
fire, but...
not a clue.
I'm going to go with the logic that they burn them with their intense gaze.
Yeah, sure. And then how do they make things appear? You want to explain the giant armor, Sovek?
Hatred.
How does an eyeball give armor?
Because hatred. Because back then, remember, we established that the Uchiha ran on the curse of hatred. And then after that, we had decided to completely abandon this idea and say, no, the Uchiha love too much. They don't hate too much. Which completely invalidated the explanation of Susanoo. That Susanoo technically wasn't awakened by the Sharingan. It was not actually an eye power. It was just awakening that much pure Uchiha blood awakened a non-eye power based on the inherent hatred of the Uchiha clan toward everyone else. And then they get rid of the whole hatred concept. And then it's just based on the fact that they love too much. And then you're just sitting there going, well, then why does Susanoo give off an aura of pure hatred? they never consolidate this, ever.
Bad writing. I'm just one of, that's what it boils down to.
Yeah, bad writing. Bad writing.
Because Uchiha needed 50 books of fluff for their bloodline, unlike everyone else.
Yeah.
That's my biggest problem, is that the everyone else has bloodlines. There's a crap ton of other bloodlines in Naruto, but the Uchiha get like 500 pages worth of ideas for their bloodline. Everyone else gets left by the wayside because more time needs to be given to the Uchiha. Because if Sasuke doesn't get a power up, Naruto scales him, outscales him, and then therefore the main conflict of the story is gone. Maybe we shouldn't have made the main conflict power based.
Yeah.
In that. Or maybe we shouldn't have made it so Sasuke's only powers that he gets now, even though he used to have different powers. He used to have, like, the whole, like, intelligence stuff.
He used
stuff.
To have curse power.
His only powers now are from the Sharingan. Nothing else.
Whatever happened to his curse powers at the end of, before the time skip?
Back when he was fighting Itachi, when I mentioned the whole bullshit ceiling sword thing, Itachi Susanoo had a special ninja item that he somehow managed to trap inside of his Susanoo. This ended up causing something really stupid to happen. This sword could seal anything it cut. At one point during the fight, his curse mark goes into overdrive and Orochimaru comes out of it and takes the form of an eight-headed snake. He then immediately gets stabbed by the sword, which is when you find out the sword even exists in the first place. Like, stab! As soon as it comes out, stab. That's the sword I was looking for that I've never mentioned before that can seal anything it touches. And then he gets sealed inside the gourd that the sword comes out of, and then Itachi dies, sealing him away.
Yep.
No lead up to this thing's existence whatsoever. Just, haha, suddenly Orochimaru appears. Just out of the blue. No lead up to that either.
So, let me get this straight. They wrote in a long time ago a perfect means of keeping the power balance good, and they fucked it up.
Yep. And also, when they sealed Orochimaru, that somehow sucked the curse mark with it, so the curse mark was taken away. All of this was apparently part of Itachi's grand plan. Once he had heard that Sasuke had been bitten by Orochimaru and given the curse mark, it was all part of a giant plan to get rid of the curse mark so that his brother would be free of the curse mark.
Mm-hmm. There should have been an easier way.
Because apparently if you piss off someone with a curse mark enough, especially Sasuke in the case where he'd actually absorbed Orochimaru when Orochimaru tried to steal his body, he actually stole Orochimaru's body instead. Somehow. I'm not quite sure how exactly it works. But anyway, apparently he somehow not only knew about this, but knew that if he pissed off Sasuke enough, it would weaken his willpower and Orochimaru would try to come out and take over. And that at that moment, he could not only seal Orochimaru, but take the curse mark away by doing that.
Still confused to how Itachi even knew that Sasuke got the curse mark, you know. Seeing as no one really said that.
Yes, I think Kakashi told him.
Oh, okay.
I think Kakashi told him before the time skip. And no, they told him after the time skip when they run into the doubles of Kakashi and Kisame. The Kakashi
Why
double
did he tell
asked
him?
About Sasuke, and he said Orochimaru has him. I don't know.
Can we agree that Naruto's been getting weird?
Yeah,
I know, very stupid.
Getting weird?
They suck at foreshadowing. And they've created power levels, which never ends well, because you have to just keep increasing the power levels.
Yeah. Anything that invokes the constant power levels is subject to the problem that power levels have to keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And at some point, unless you pre-plan every single arc, it's going to get ridiculous.
Yeah. It's very hard
to
get
over 9,000 already and get over it.
It's very hard to get out of power levels once you get into them. I've only seen it done once, and that was just One Piece saying, fuck it, no more power levels.
Dragon Ball Z got out of it eventually. After the Freezer saga, they gave up with the idea of power
levels.
Well,
no, they stopped saying power levels, but the power levels were still there. They still had to keep coming up with more and more bombastic abilities to defeat their new enemies.
Quite literally, they just decided to say, this isn't even my final form.
Yeah. They literally had, by the end, Frieza was one of the weakest villains because of how the power levels had progressed. Things like the androids seemed like they could take on Frieza one-on-one. That's what power levels do. They make it so your initial bad guys seem so inconsequential And that's the main problem with them.
End.
So, like most RPGs?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
And you never want that. You never want your initial bad guys just to seem completely pointless because of how you've made things.
Yeah.
That's why Bleach should have ended after Aizen.
Yeah. Well, granted, Bleach probably should have ended after the whole bring back Rukia thing.
Yeah, it should have. Bleach should never have even gotten to Aizen.
Next topic, Selek.
Yeah, the next topic, which is going to be complete 180, item degradation right? Games. No, item degradation video games. Why? Why do some games continue to include the concept of item wear and tear that aren't MMOs?
Because MMOs shouldn't do it either.
Well, I was about to say, even MMOs shouldn't do it. It's just...
It's all about the grind, yo.
It's just...
People dig the grind.
I mean...
I can't stand it.
I really have no problem with item degradation. Degradation.
I don't
seem that annoying to me.
It's done properly. If you do it with the Fallout 3 and Fallout New Vegas method, where there's an easy and farmable way of carrying on two ways of repairing your items, where you just, I just have to have two of the same gun and I can repair my gun, or I have to have two similar hats to repair my hat, and so on and so forth. That isn't bad, because for more common weapons, that means you're going to have a steady supply of repair, thus making your common weak weapons pretty much constantly able to be used. But then the rare stuff you have to hang on to because the replacement parts are hard to come by. That's a good way of doing it, where it not only balances the weapons, it balances the whole mechanic. The thing I really hate is something like the what's that game? The one that
last time I tried to play Shining Force 2, had item degradation of a main item of the game. The main sword that your character is given is an family heirloom. You have 20 uses on. And I'm going, well, that means I can't use this awesome sword you've just given me at all, because you've given it at the fucking beginning of the game.
That's, there's a big point to item degradation in strategy RTSs. It's so you can't keep using the same superpowered weapon over and over.
Yeah, it forces you to use a weak weapon.
It wasn't even that superpowered either. It was a decent weapon. It wasn't even that big of an item, but if you let that break, it's game over.
Yeah.
If I remember Shining Force, it's because later on in the game it becomes stupidly broken. But they just didn't implement the repair system later on. Like, that's the whole point in most strategy RTSs. It's just like, you have this superpowered weapon. We don't want you using it over and over and over.
And over,
so we're
going
to make a break. That's why Fire Emblem usually has like a very hard to get repair item. Because they don't want you doing this nonsense.
Then don't give us the fucking item until later then!
I like Oblivion's little item thing.
I don't.
You don't?
For one reason. Have to farm the ability to repair your weapons effectively.
Yeah, and that's kind of a pain.
That gets annoying. I don't care that the scaling in Oblivion is broken and allows it to be quickly. That does not excuse the mechanic itself. That just means in that one game, it's not as bad a deal as it could have been. If that game had been coded properly with the way leveling up abilities would have worked, it would have taken forever to get your repair skill up. If they had actually thought about the mechanic in the way that they were clearly trying to do it, where repairing items was meant to be very difficult early on. Repairing items should not be more or less difficult based on what level of the game you're at. It should just be a flat, this is what it takes to repair items, which is also sometimes bullshit, because then you get into things like Kingdoms of Amalur, where it uses the MMO route where all your items completely degrade over time, eventually breaking unless you go back to town and spend ridiculous amounts of money disproportional to the value of the item to repair them.
Yeah, it's annoying as hell.
I mean,
MMOs with item degradation, that's there just to make you grind more.
Yeah, especially
and in the act of grinding more, you have to repair your stuff more, which means you got to grind more to get the money, and which means you got to repair more, and it's just an endless cycle of fuck you.
Yeah, because what happens in MLR, especially if you have the DLC involved, it's very easy to get mid to late tier items that are wearable and usable at the very beginning of the game. Because of the rarity of the items and the strength of the items, the price to repair them is astronomical compared to the actual gear you would be getting from non-DLC areas that you can just go to and complete very easily at the beginning of the game. So you go do your DLC, the Teeth of Naveros is the one I did. I came out of the Teeth of Naveros wearing fucking mid-tier, end-tier level gear, and I was only like level 10. And the cost to upgrade them was worth 20 times what I was getting from any given side quest. Even the main quest were only giving me 10% of like the cost of repairing one of my items. The point where I had to risk breaking an item just to farm enemies to repair the item. That's not good item repair mechanics. Which is exactly why I hate certain mechanics when it comes to item repair. It's just there needs to be better ways of item repair. Or at least a flat rate for items in some way. Like, you know, all armors cost this much to repair at this degradation level. Don't scale it by how rare the armor is. Because if you somehow get a very rare armor early on, you're never going to be able to repair it. And so you'll never wear it.
And then it just takes inventory space, and it's exactly fucking annoying.
Because there's only, like, one place in the entirety of Kingdoms of Amalur where you have a trunk you can store stuff in. And so you would have to constantly fast travel back and forth, which wouldn't be bad if Kingdoms of Amalur let you fast travel to every location in the game. But it doesn't. You can only fast travel to certain very, very important areas, such as major towns and very major quest areas. Those are the only places you can fast travel to, which makes fast traveling in that game kind of annoying. I tend to just do as many quests as I can in an area, and then move on to the area, which is usually like the opposite end of the zone from where you got the quest. And then my map will show me, hey, there's quest givers over in this corner of the map. And I'll be like, you know what? I'm not going to turn that quest I just did. I'm going to go talk to these guys and see if they have a closer quest. No, their quest is over there, but it pays more. So I'm going to go do that quest. The next thing I know, I have like 20 unresolved quests in my inventory. And it'll take me forever to go around returning them all in.
There's a lot of problems with Kingdoms of MLR.
Yeah, but that in and of itself is indicative of why, if you're going to have a centralized space where you store inventory, and you're going to also have an item degradation mechanic, you absolutely need to balance the two together. Because if it's annoying to go back to where I was after I've gone to my stash to put my stuff, I'm not going to go back to my stash to put my stuff away. It's just, I'm not going to do it. I will not get back to my quest area if I go back to that stash, and I don't like a game that forces me to make that choice. Do I continue what I do, or do I go back to my stash and go back to square one? That shouldn't be a choice. It should just be, oh, I have to go back to my stash. Hang on a second. Okay, I'm back. Where was I? Like Diablo. Diablo has item wear, and you have to pay for the items, and it scales up with level, but you can drop town portals and go back to the exact fucking spot you were at when you picked up the items that you had to drop off and then repair your stuff while you were there.
Yeah.
Yeah, Diablo 2 is actually an example of how you can do it without it being annoying as hell.
Yeah.
Because when your item, quote-unquote, breaks, you don't lose the item, if I remember right. I don't really let an item get that far, but I think it just kind of makes it useless.
I could be wrong, but no, I think items do actually break in Diablo.
Am I thinking of a different game where that happens?
Amalur does that. If it breaks...
In Diablo, they break forever.
Yeah, they break forever, which is why ethereal items are shit.
Ethereal items are bullshit. That's right. I'm thinking of another game that actually does it better, where when the item breaks, you can't use the item until you get it fixed.
Yeah, Fallout does
which
that.
Which is the best way of doing it.
Fallout does that. Amalur does that. Diablo does not, but Diablo does that for a reason with ethereal weapons, because ethereal weapons are meant to be used by druids. Because when a druid uses an ethereal weapon, his connection to the ethereal plane means it doesn't degrade.
Yeah, Diablo 2, they did a good job with it. You know, the best way of doing item degradation is you don't lose the item. It just breaks, and you go to get it fixed, and you're having a good day.
To be fair, I think it's just Diablo 1 that does the break forever. I think Diablo 2, it just sits in your inventory. You can't use it.
No, that's Diablo what 2 I thought. Breaks. No, Diablo 2, it breaks.
Does it break?
Yeah, it does. I have actually broken items in Diablo 2. They outright break, and then you can't do anything with them. Which is why you should never let your items hit zero in Diablo 2.
Yeah, I never do, but it's easy enough to fix that because the way Diablo 2 works, everything works.
Yeah, everything just works. The way Diablo 2 is a perfect example of if you're going to do item degradation, make it that way because it gives you so much loot that all item degradation is a cut into your spending money. And frankly, if you're playing on Battle.net, you don't need spending money because the drop rates on Battle.net are amazing. So,
yeah.
Where's the policy button? Policy, there we go. And that brings, I think, to our next topic, long RPGs that are fun. I have found too many RPGs that have come out in the last, I don't want to say 5 years, because I think that cuts into the last of some of the good RPGs, but just in recent years, RPGs have just been getting shorter and shorter and shorter to the point where people look at a game like, say, Final Fantasy VII, because that's the first one I could think of that's 300 hours plus, and say, I don't want to play that game solely because it's so many hundreds of hours. But back then, games had content for all those hundreds of hours. Usually unique content. There was usually something you're doing that's causing you to take up that much time. In Final Fantasy VII's case, what took up those hundreds of hours was three specific things. Chocobo breeding, hunting the American secret bosses, and getting Knights of the Round. Those three things alone were anywhere from 100 to 150 hours of gameplay.
Average was 40 to 80, honestly.
Well, it depends on the person. It depends on how well you played Final Fantasy VII, to be perfectly honest. But
true.
For some of us who weren't great at chocobo breeding in the first place, because we just had really shit luck and we didn't want to do it the cheap way, it could take 100 to 150 hours just to get up to a gold chocobo so you could get Knights of the Round and go all the places you needed to go to get all the different bosses.
Yeah.
Honestly, flags on every street corner. I like it.
But, yeah, a lot of RPGs nowadays seem to be a lot shorter, or they have a lot more fluff than actual game.
I've noticed a lot of new RPGs, they still keep the grindiness of the old ones, but that's all it is. It's nothing but grind.
They're replacing content with grind.
And that's just not cool.
No, it is not cool.
I mean, yeah, the old games had a ton of grind, and oh god, it's annoying as hell sometimes. But there was story that actually kept you involved. There was character development that kept you interested.
Yeah.
Now it's not. I haven't seen too many new RPGs that I've actually wanted to play.
Yeah, I just kind of keep going back to, like, Dragon Quest Journey of the Cursed King.
Yeah.
What was that? That was 8, right?
Yeah.
Alright, I keep forgetting the subtitles.
Hell, Dragon Age 8 was fun. Dragon Age is what? Origins is 30 hours, roughly, if you do everything 30 to 60 hours.
It depends.
But it's not grind. It's content. It's 30 to 60 hours of content. That's how you do a shorter RPG that isn't hundreds of hours long, and you do it right. You fill it with content.
Content, you say? Blasphemy.
That's how I feel it seems some days. Is people are like, what do you mean you want content? No, we're going to charge you $60 for this really short-ass game that's nothing but grinding. And you're going to feel miserable when you're done. Oh, yeah.
Bitches love the grind, yo.
They love the grind. Oh, my God. But that's just my little rant on the subject.
If I wanted grind, I'd go play World of Warcraft.
Actually, not that much grind here.
I know, but used to be there was a lot more grind. Now they're actually kind of getting fun.
Back
but...
when I was playing, there was
back in
but
my
grind.
Day. It took us 10 years to get to level 59 to 60.
Had to sit there killing demons for those goddamn bears in their tunnel. The bears. Bear. Why do I have to kill 500 demons for them? Screw you, bears. You don't even give good loot.
And yet, there are MMOs that can avoid the grind. I actually really enjoyed Lord of the Rings Online because even though you were grinding, it didn't feel like you were grinding because every quest was actually something unique. It wasn't just, oh, go do this because do it. It was go do this because you're actually contributing in some greater way to the overall fight. They actually did a decent way of hiding the grind behind Lord of the Rings fluff. Whereas other games, it's just like, no, you need to go kill things because your level isn't high enough. Just kill them until you're a higher level, then come talk to me. That's not good grinding. Good grinding makes you feel like you're accomplishing something, even if all you're really doing is grinding.
Yeah, I don't care I have to kill 100 boar level up. I want to know why I want to kill the boars and why the boars deserve death.
Yeah.
Give me a good reason to genocide all the boars, and I'll do it.
The boars are being driven evil and mad by the dark power influence of Sauron's growing influence, and it's causing them to go wild and feral, and they're threatening farmers. So thin the herd, so that farmers can go out safely into their lands. That's a valid reason to go kill 10 boars. Or we're really hungry, we want to do a feast, we really want to have boars meat. Go kill 5 boars for the feast. And while you're at it, go kill the bears so that our hunters can go out and kill boars while you're out there.
That's another thing you brought up, say like boar meat. How come in certain games you'll be like, collect a zebra hoof? Okay, I kill zebra. Zebra not drop hoof. Why does zebra not drop hoof? Yeah, they have four hooves!
I know the official stated answer for that one. Because you have, in attacking the animal with your special attacks, you have caused too much damage to collect the hoof or fur or whatever.
Yeah, I always assumed that. Like,
which is
you fucked up
stupid.
By attacking it.
Yeah,
I am hunter with gun and I shoot it in head. How did I hit hoof?
I don't know. How did I shoot an arrow through a wolf's head and then get a perfect wolf head trophy as a hat afterwards? I mean...
Yeah. You're an amazing taxidermist.
I'm so amazing at taxidermy, I can undo arrow shots to the face.
I understand there's reasonings, but you're telling me that every single one on there...
Yeah, but
what did I do? Hunt it with a rocket launcher?
That is why I loved Lord of the Rings Online's drop system. Everything you have to kill for a quest drops the item. If you have to kill 5 of these things, the first 5 you kill will drop all 5 you need. Because just, I mean, like pig's ears. There was one of them I had to collect pig's ears. And I killed 5 pigs, and they dropped 5 ears. They have 2 ears, so it's kind of bullshit, but you know, I figured maybe I manged 1 ear on my arrows.
I always call it bullshit when they might want you to drop something like pig's ears or goblin ears, and you don't get 2 on the drop.
Yeah.
Maybe it's like pairs of ears. You need to get 5 pairs of ears.
Or maybe the pig's just deaf, and his ears don't work.
Exactly. But, that's some of the things I love, and I believe that can take us into our next topic. We are a little low on time, so I think we are going to once again gloss past the awesomeness that is Air Pirates. We only have Flux, we're not doing opera.
Damn it. Why won't you let me bring culture to this podcast? You won't let my opera ideas go.
Because
you won't let my,
we are
my plays.
Talking of, culture is in the podcast. Geek culture, not opera culture. Wrong culture.
What do you think about Moby Dick?
I actually really enjoyed Moby Dick. Gregory Peck is amazing.
You insist on putting in the wrong culture. Don't think you know what that word means.
So I think just to close out today, Red Fox wanted to talk a little bit about Robin Williams, who unfortunately did pass away earlier this week. I love his movies. I love him as an actor. I love him as a comedian. I loved his TV shows. And it is sad that he is gone. I still remember watching Mork and Mindy with my dad when it was on reruns on like TV Land, and I thought it was the funniest shit ever.
It's just a shame, though, that give it about 2 weeks to a month, and everyone will forget about how serious depression problems can be. Because they do it all the time. Someone dies because they commit suicide.
I'm gonna play devil's advocate here, even though I probably shouldn't. I do get tired of my Facebook wall and my Twitter account being spammed with people talking about depression 24/7 when anyone remotely famous or well known dies, and depression is the root cause.
But so, how can we stop depression without Facebook likes?
I am a man who has off and on had bouts of depression for most of my life since I was a child. And I don't like it being just kind of out there. I'm very private about it. I get help when it flares up. I often have managed to avoid medication. I usually just find something that helps me cope and then I'm good. But
yeah.
As someone who suffers from depression, I don't want to be reminded about all the different ways to solve depression for like a week solid out of everyone's mouth when depression causes someone to die. Okay, yeah, he died. It was depression. It's sad. Those of us who are depressed already know how to get help if we want to get help. Some of us just don't want to get help from other people. So, kindly get out of our fucking face. I mean, that's just...
Well, there's also the problem that... Well, there are some cases where some people don't know what to do about it. There are other cases, though, where our fucking medical system won't ever actually cover medical problems of the mind, such as depression, and that sucks. Still, I do find it quite sucky that we lost Robin Williams.
He was awesome. I'm very much want to try and find some of his movies I haven't seen in a while and watch them now. I wanted to watch them for a while, and now more so than ever, I feel like I should go watch them.
In fact, I tried to do I found out the library already put all of the movies.
My fiance just reminded me of when I need to add to that list. I need to add Flubber to the list, because I'm one of those few people who genuinely enjoyed the hell out of Flubber.
Flubber!
Even though apparently Flubber was a massive flop, and I think she just heard someone yell Flubber. I think she heard you through my headset yell Flubber.
It sounded more like rubber.
Well, Flubber is rubber, so you know.
But seriously though, everyone has been thinking that around here, because my local library, all of the movies that Robin Williams was in, every single one, is now on a 3 month long waiting list.
Yeah.
Wow.
Of holds.
Oh,
yeah.
Dude. I went to watch Star Trek Generations today, because I've been on a Next Generation era movie binge desire lately. So I go to watch today, and our living room TV has an Apple TV hooked up to it, and sweet. Apple TV has its own movie thing where you can buy movies off of the Apple TV, and like half of the popular movies were all Robin Williams movies. Like I log in and I see like one or two movies that like just came out, and then I see Dead Poets Society, I see Aladdin on there. I just see all these different Robin Williams movies just listed one after the other, and I'm just like, wow, everyone's just got the same idea I had. We're just going to start watching Robin Williams movies now. One of the things I really want to watch, and I don't think many people ever saw this because it was on PBS, and sadly PBS things don't get viewed very often, the thing he did where he was narrating dolphins.
God, I forgot about that.
I loved that. I was camping, and it was like a really rainy, stormy night, and we were just barely pulling it in on the antenna, because this was before they did the big digital switch, and we could still actually watch shit in the trailer off of the antenna on the roof. And, you know, it's a stormy night. We can't do a campfire, so we stay inside. We usually try and pull in the local PBS, and there's Robin Williams talking over fish on a documentary, and it was great. He's just talking about being the dolphins. And it reminded me, like, how much of a good straight-up comedian he can be, and not just as an actor. And I want to track that down at some point and watch that again.
Why did they have to take him? All he ever wanted to do is bring joy.
I have just been told that in high school he was voted least likely to succeed in life.
Least what? Wait.
Least he was voted in his high school class the least likely of his class to succeed.
Wow.
And look where he ended up.
One of the most successful men ever.
Yeah, one of the most successful men in entertainment. One of the most beloved as well. And
yeah, it really is a shame that he is gone, because most of our childhoods have been touched by Robin Williams.
In one way or another. At least a little bit.
But not that way.
No, not in a Michael Jackson way.
Not in that way.
I'm sorry, I had to.
It's okay. Lord Cat and I started with the dark humor jokes about it like almost immediately.
Dude, Robin Williams had an awesome sense of humor about these type of things anyway.
Oh yeah.
He made the dark humor jokes.
Oh yeah.
If you actually watch his stand up, some of it is hilariously dark. Oh, yeah.
That's why I was not afraid to make a few dark humor comments, because Robin Williams helped make dark humor popular in the mainstream. A lot of his stand up was dark humor.
So even in his passing, we have to look at the humor of things.
Always
because that's the right thing to do.
Always look at the bright side.
That wasn't Robin Williams. That was Monty Python.
Yes, that was.
What's your point, Fluxen?
You're getting your act confused, Sovek. Robin Williams was like Flubber and Ghostbusters and Caddyshack, that kind of stuff.
What?
I think only one of those was actually right. I'm pretty sure he was neither in Caddyshack nor Ghostbusters.
Wasn't he the one going for the gopher?
No, he was not the one going for the gopher, you son of a bitch.
Yeah, that's Bill Murray, you asshole.
In fact, actually, out of that list, I think Robin Williams was only in one of those, and Bill Murray was only in two of those. So he failed at both accounts.
Whatever. I don't know actors.
Neither do I, for the most part, but yeah, unfortunately, not only are people going to stop with the reminding people that depression is a serious thing, people are going to also most likely stop talking about the fact that it's sad that Robin Williams passed almost as soon as the weekend's over, probably.
Well, probably. It also doesn't help that Fox News decided to call Robin Williams a coward.
Well, it's Fox News. I mean,
God damn it,
Fox News can go jump into a pit.
Actually, this morning, the guy who said that yesterday has apologized.
Did he?
Still, fuck him. Really had to. The Fox got tons of phone calls.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. This is a big PR nightmare after he said that.
Oh, well, yeah, I mean, it's a very beloved person. Fox News only has so much clout to get rid of little gaffes like that.
No, if they said he was a communist, maybe people would believe him.
That's Minister of Transport.
See, I'd buy a communist.
Yeah.
I can see it. It's kind of stupid, but yeah. So is that all we're talking about today, or do we have some time?
I think really that's all we're going to talk about today. What time is it now? Yeah.
4:11.
We have like 10 minutes until we catch up to a full hour mark. So
Beth.
Do you want to quickly go over Air Pirates? And why they're awesome?
Air Pirates are awesome because of Skies of Arcadia, and I don't know if we could do justice to why people should all go out and hunt down copies of Skies of Arcadia in 10 minutes.
Actually, no, don't say that, because that'll bankrupt people, because it's fucking expensive nowadays.
Wait, how? God damn.
What system
it's like
it
100.
For?
Dude, I own a copy of Skies of Arcadia, and I'm glad I do.
GameCube version's like $100.
Yeah,
it is. Last time.
I have
the Dreamcast version is the cheapest, surprisingly.
Well, I'll tell you exactly why. There's enough time to tell you why. The Dreamcast version fucking sucks.
Yeah.
The Dreamcast version is not a good game. There's random battles every half step. The game has very little content outside of you can buy and sell ships and get ships besides the Delphinus and the Little Jack. And while that's cool and all, I am not sad that it was missing when they made the remake and they decided, let's do this whole bounty thing and this whole like discovery stuff. That's really awesome. And just make them only have the story ships, because there's no reason to ever get rid of the Delphinus.
How the fuck did the Explorer guy work if there wasn't discoveries in the original game?
Actually, no, there were
discoveries.
There were discoveries in the original game, but they added more in the remake.
And if you don't get the original, then how can you ever play Fat Belly's quests? I can't remember what his name is. Little Fat... the furry guys.
You can't do Pinta's quests anyway.
Yeah, you can do it on the Dreamcast.
No, because you need that special attachment. And that, I think that special attachment's actually kind of expensive nowadays.
He was in the memory card.
Yeah, that's the other thing.
The VMU only came out in Japan.
Yeah, that's a good point. You cannot, if you get the American version of Skies of Arcadia for the Dreamcast, you cannot do his quests anyway.
No, Fat Belly.
Because his quest...
because it was only in Japan.
Yeah, the peripheral for it was never released in America. Or anywhere else.
I'm certain the peripheral was just the Dreamcast memory cards.
No, it was a VMU that acted like a memory card.
Yeah.
VMU was the peripheral, and it was a flop. Which kind of sucked, because it was a good idea.
Oh yeah, it was a great idea, but it is what it is. But yeah, that's why the remake was just phenomenal. It's a great game. And then when I finally found someone who had actually like written anything about the original game, and I was reading the differences between the original and the remake, I'm just like, I suddenly have absolutely no interest to see the original. The only thing that would be cool about it would be having different ships.
Or having the dancer being useful.
Well, yeah, because which I think is funny. The dancer's whole usefulness was it made your ship worth more when you sold it, but you kept the dancer.
Yeah, well, it's the same thing as having a, like, half-naked girl next to a car. More people want the car, so like...
That's true. It is the same logic.
You don't get the girl with the car unless you're in, like, Russia, but you still want the car.
If you're in Soviet Russia, girl will come with car. Oh, man. But, yeah, I think Skies of Arcadia can be touched on more another week. Next week, I think, is going to be just mostly a Star Wars week, and coincidentally, I just lost my game as we're finishing here. Timing!
Yay! Timing. Oh, wait, no, that's bad. Ooh.
That is timing. Alrighty then. So I'm going to exit my game here, and I'd like to thank anyone who is watching. Remember, next week, special Star Wars episode. I will be playing Star Wars games on stream, just to go with the mood. My co-host today, as you know, were Fluxin, Red Fox, and Zonrazer.
Hail Hydra.
always Hail Hydra. Fuck Shield. Shield does not give me bases that spawn new bases when they're destroyed for some bullshit reason. I don't understand how Hydra's whole system fucking works. anyway, if you want to see us other places, if you saw this live, you already know where my stream is. If you don't, it's twitch.tv/SovekOnivorous. You can catch Red Fox weekday nights at twitch.tv/RedFox_NightFox and Flux whenever the fuck he feels like it at twitch.tv/Flux.
Yeah, if I ever start streaming again.
If you ever start streaming again. You get hit pretty hard with Twitch changes. I'm still a little iffy on whether or not I'm staying here myself. I'm waiting to see how the wind shifts with the shitstorm.
as we all are, honestly.
If you enjoyed the podcast and you want to support us in making this podcast and others, you can go to patreon.com/SovekOnivorous to donate, and that'll help support both the stream and my podcasts so that we can keep doing this more in the future.
Or you can send boob pictures to Fluxin at Twitter, which is also an appreciated way of showing your appreciation to the podcast.
Okay. All right. I'll accept that, yes. The other acceptable thing is to send Flux pictures of tits. All right. So thank you all for watching once again. This is
and
us
make
all.
Sure though, make sure you send him great pictures of birds.
That's a good point. Flux did not specify female tits, so go ahead and send your man tits right the fuck now. Thank you. Goodbye.
I'm cool.
And I stopped it as soon as I said thank you. Goodbye. Even though you said you're cool with it.
I ain't discriminatory.
Or just pictures of birds.
They're good quality man tits. I'm all for it.
True, he didn't specify.
Yo, he didn't specify, hun. Oh, man. Okay.
I can link it to a bird as well.
You know what the worst part is? I haven't gotten around to shutting off the MUMP recording yet.